everyone and welcome back to Rewrite. Let's continue. I get out my cell phone. I can't get a connection. Maybe there's too many people here. My phone's not working. Why can't I text anyone? I've been trying to call him. So it's not just me. I guess the network is just overloaded right now. This crowd is pretty ridiculous. I better get back to Kotori. What's with the music? I see what might be enemies ahead of me. Well, shit. It's not a big deal, but the way they're walking feels a little off. Somehow, it's telling me those people have superpowers. They might be familiar hunters like Imamiya. People with powers and abilities beyond normal humans. They're organized, have access to firearms, and won't hesitate to kill. They're looking for the key. And they know about me and Kotori. I try taking a detour, but there's a huge crowd there too. I get swept up by it. If there was no one around, I could just climb up a building. Isn't that the guy? They found me. Even amidst all this chatter, I can hear words directed at me. They're pretty far away, but they're definitely the guys I saw a minute ago. One of them's pointing at me and talking to a second guy. They hesitate for a moment, but they can't follow me through this crowd. I just have to break my way through this mob before they do. They try using their cell phones, but they probably won't work either. I can see them acting puzzled. So I don't need to worry about more of them showing up. Okay. Kya! A homosexual pervert! Suddenly the crowd parts. Well, the men do anyway. No matter how dense the crowds, this always works. I rush through the opening. Kotori and the others are fine. Once we meet up, we start walking toward less crowded areas. In the end, we are gonna have to do this on foot. Walking and walking. Staying far away from the city and the train lines. Oh, a new background. We are surrounded by golden wheat now. The waves rolling through the field remind me of a movie. This place is amazing. But there's nothing here. We are trying to get away from the city and go somewhere no one can find us. No matter where we end up, we're going to be secluding ourselves from the world. Let's go. We start walking. Through the golden fields. How far have we gone? I tried using my cell phone to check the time, but the battery's dead. Damn, is your phone still charged? Kotori shakes her head. We are completely cut off from civilization now. The reception's probably terrible out here anyway. Any idea what time it is? I see. It feels like we've been walking for a while, but it also feels like the sun hasn't moved and the scenery hasn't changed. I don't like this. At least the key's being nice and quiet. We start walking again. We don't say much. Kotori, myself and the key are all silent. There's nothing to talk about. When there's no reason to crack jokes, I can't come up with anything to say. So I start thinking about the past. Is this how ancient people felt when they crossed continents to start a new life? I almost feel like I'm walking through a dream. The sunlight is neither hot nor cold, but the carpet of grain reflects its light, filling the world with a mysterious glow. It's almost like I'm walking toward heaven. My whole body feels dull, and everything in the past feels meaningless now. My stomach growls. Hunger clears my mind. Come to think of it, I haven't eaten in a while. Should we take a break? It's almost noon now. Kotori points ahead. There's a small hut there. Is that a storehouse for the farmers? It's wooden, but so run down it looks more like wet tissue. It's hard to imagine it will keep the wind off us. But it's probably good enough to take a break in. It's still a little warm. Have some. Please, just eat something. I hand her a box with hot dogs and salad. I open the flask and pour some coffee into the lid. I have a bunch of syrup too. You need nourishment if we're gonna keep walking, right? I pass the cup to Kotori, who's sitting down on the floor. Kotori is exhausted, as if she just finished crying. Come on. After I push her, she takes a small sip. Having some sugar ought to make her a bit more energetic. I finish eating my chili dog. At least I still have an appetite. This is good. Nice and spicy. I devour both of them in no time and move on to the salad. I work through it like a caterpillar, then drink 2 cups of coffee and finally feel satisfied. Kotori doesn't touch her food and lets her coffee go cold. Ever since leaving the forest, or maybe even before then, Kotori hasn't felt alive. Like a mother exhausted after raising a child. Or maybe an old woman on the verge of death. As for the key, she's been standing still, staring at a single point on the wall for several minutes. She could probably do that for hours. Kotori's parents are sitting down motionless. They're not alive. It's still hard to accept. I understand it, but only in a cold, logical way. Hey, you two. She says to knock me down. Something bothers me about that. So, when did they die? Before or after you became a druid? Did they both die at the same time? After I ask her enough questions, she starts telling the story all on her own. In the air? I considered staying quiet and listening, but I couldn't help but ask. Just hearing about it makes me shiver. I'm at a loss for words.
後で、シートに引っかかったりして遅れて飛び出したんだと思う。覚えてるのは遠くの空を飛んでいくお父さんとお母さんの姿。笑っちゃった。童話みたいな光景だったから。メアリーポピンズとかあんなの。でも下を見ると森が見えて 何も考えられなかった。怖いとさえ思わなかった。冗談めいてたから、お父さんたちが遠くの空に行っちゃう、そんな不安だけだった。で、気がついたら、私は森に転がってた。今思うと、あれは奇跡だったんだろうなって思う。大きな怪我もしてなかった。 多分枝とかに引っかかって、それでうまく落ちたんじゃないかな。私は森で2人を探した。長いこと歩いてやっと見つけたけど、2人はもう形もわかんなくなっちゃってた。怖かった。私、お母さんにすがりつくこともできなかった。
お母さんの顔がどこかもわからなかった。だから逃げちゃった。めちゃくちゃ歩いて疲れ果てて、気がついたらヤドリギが手に絡みついてた。そのヤドリギがね、魔物だったの。え、seriously?ちびもすみたいな魔物じゃなくて、 素質のある人間に知識と力を与える、そういうの。私にはその素質があったみたい。ヤドリギは死者でも生き返らせる力をくれるって言ってた。ただし、鍵に石を使えるって条件だったけど。あとはわかるよね。It
was too good to be true. Kotori nodded.
昔の人はあれが蘇生だって 受け入れていたみたい。光栄なことでもあるって思ってたんじゃないかな。強くなるし、おしゃべりしなくなるし、忠実になるし。何が福音の奇跡だい。こんなの呪いだよね。
Her voice changes right at the end. She starts sniffling. I had no idea that's what happened. Ever since she was a little girl, she's been working as a druid and controlling her parents. Without anyone to comfort her, she's had to raise herself. Pero was the same.
ペロの時はもう割り切ってたし。そんなには辛くなかったよ。魔物は生きてない。心なんてないって。宿り木の記憶にもあったし。だから道具だって。これは道具だって。She
couldn't have kept herself going otherwise.
死んだ直後なら臓器の一部だけを魔物化することで 擬似的な蘇生を成立させることができるかもって考えたの。私はその方法をずっと研究してきた。Did
you revive him?
うん。失敗。ただの魔物になっちゃった。
I see. Is it impossible for familiars to have a soul?
私の知る限りないみたい。長く生きた魔物の中には稀に魂のようなものが宿ることがあるみたい。
I see. That resolves a lot of questions. Now I know why Kotori felt so distant sometimes. She was always alone on the inside. Was I too full of myself? I always thought you went to high school because I was there, Kotori. Was I wrong? Ah, thank goodness. I finally got the whole truth out of her. I'm more relieved than I am happy. I'm satisfied now. I'm okay if things end now. But there's one more thing. One last question I'd like answered. I resist the urge to hug her and ask. There's one thing I need to check. I smile at her. On the inside, I'm praying. Please, don't force Kotori to suffer anymore. Kotori? Am I a familiar? At first, I thought my question went unheard. I wait patiently. What? That was the last cruel blow.
Huh.
Ah, I do remember that.
どういう経緯かは分からない。当時、小太郎くんは探偵ごっこみたいなことをよくしてた。Playing
detective? That does ring a bell.
その子を助けようとした小太郎くんは鍵取って食わした。現場はひどいありさまだったよ。女の子は意識がなかっただけだったけど、小太郎くんは
And you healed me.
その後は頭の怪我もあったし、入院してもらって。知っての通りだよ。
I'm here. I have a soul.
お父さんたちとは違って、小太郎くんは話すし、判断もできる。でも、それも私の願望じゃないって言い切ることはできない。
No, that's not true. I do still have memories from when I was a little kid. Kotori clings to me. Her eyes are desperate. Stop talking like that. Don't give up. Please. I hold her shoulders. Kotori leans into my chest. Let's live as long as we can, okay? She nods very slightly. The key sings faintly. In modern human terms, the song is only about one bar long, only an instant. But we are at a loss for words. We are instinctively afraid of this song. Why is that? Kotori stands up. Then Keisuke-san takes what looks like a long stick out of his bag. A hunting rifle. As I watch in shock, he points it at the key. Wait a minute! I grab the gun barrel and push it away. What's wrong with you? Isn't the key important? Society will get torn apart, right? But that's just part of Earth's ecosystem, so... At that moment, I sense a dangerous presence outside the hut. Give me that gun for a second. I pick it up and put it on the table. I look outside through a broken part of the window. Our hut is surrounded by black dogs. We are surrounded. Fortunately, I don't see any hunters. But black dogs are hard enough. I can't even kill one of them, much less a whole pack. And these walls aren't strong enough to keep them out. Not much choice. The only way for us to survive this is if I drive them all away. Using this rifle? I've never used it before. There's no way I'll manage that. Which means there's only one thing I can do. I hear a violent noise inside the room. Pikako-san just took a large chainsaw out of its carrying case and turned it on. The kind with an attached engine. No woman could use something that heavy. But Rikako-san's holding it up like it's nothing. That's what you've been carrying? This isn't an everyday situation, so her conversation skills don't apply here. Keisuke-san stands up too. He searches through his bag. They aren't acting independently. Kudori is ordering them to do this. Hey! So you're making them fight in my place? Okay. What else can I say to that? I have no idea. Okay. So we are going to abandon them. They may be heartless familiars now, but she's kept her parents around in some form for all this time. Maybe it doesn't count, but shouldn't she be more distressed by the idea of losing them? Of course she should. Hey! Keisuke-san ruffles his wife's hair. What is it? Rikako-san answers with a soft voice. Something falls out of Kurori's hands. Something that shouldn't be possible just happened. Where'd you put my gun? The thing really needs to be kept safe. Hunters have to be very careful these days. Silly, it's right there on the table. Oh, you're right. Keisuke-san picks up his rifle. With this, I can protect my family. Yes, that's right. Now let's go. Yeah, let's. The two of them walk out the door, like a married couple about to go shopping. Before long, we hear the gun firing and the chainsaw revving. So. That conversation. Was it an illusion? Another bug? Could it really be just that? For a moment, it felt like they'd gone back to being human. Kotori, we need to go and bring the key. I drag both of them out of the hut. I do my best not to look at the battle running between the familiars being slaughtered by Keisuke-san and Rikako-san. The last things I hear were gunshots, a chainsaw, and the sound of fangs sinking into flesh. I am not looking back. I liked Keisuke-san and Rikako-san. Even if they weren't Kotori's parents, I would have liked them. But I won't look back. Why is the key laughing? As I pull her arm, the key looks back and starts laughing. As if she's enjoying this. I pull Kotori. If I let her go back, we are all dead. I'm the only one looking ahead. The key is laughing. Kotori is crying. I feel like going insane. Even after the sounds of battle fade into the distance, Kotori keeps crying. Yeah. Yeah. That's true. It is strange. Tears keep pouring out. I continue pulling them forward. My vision blurs, making it hard to walk. We have nothing but the clothes on our backs. We have no hope, but I'm going to keep moving forward. Eventually, we run out of tears. We are no longer capable of having fun or productive conversations. This must be what it's like to walk to your doom. Eventually, a small hut appears in front of us. Oh, come on. There's no fucking way. What's wrong? Are you mocking us? Are you doing all this just to ridicule us? I shout at the heavens. Should I have shouted at the earth instead? This hut is exactly the same as the one we rested in earlier. That's not possible. I know humans are bad at telling if they're walking in a straight line or not. But there's no way you can end up right back where you started. There are no bodies anywhere. I can't find any trace of battle. So it's still possible this is a different place. Familiars vanish without a trace when they die. They cease to exist as if sucked up by the fabric of time. I try opening the door. No one's inside. If there was absolutely nothing in here, then maybe I could have believed that this was a completely different, similar-looking hut. But I found all the things we left behind when we ran away. We probably went insane a long time ago. I thought we were doing our best. I'm sure we did everything we could to avoid such a catastrophic outcome. But human hearts are powerless before cruel reality. As I stand there, dejected, the key starts singing again. It pisses me off. Stop it. Stop it! I grab her shoulders and shake her. What the hell do you want? What are you after? This is all happening because we protected you. Take responsibility for it. Explain yourself. From the other side of the hut, a single black dog shows itself. A lone survivor. His muscles are the size of a bear's. The black dogs probably have some slight variations among them, so maybe this is one of the bigger guys. I see. I form a wrist blade. Jeez, reality is such a pain. The black dog rushes forward. I hold my glowing blade to one side. Just die already! I don't remember how I fought. Evidently, I won somehow. My left hand looks like a pack of rats nibbled at it. Wet, red, minced meat. There is no pain, though only because I'm not feeling it. It was a fierce fight. I vaguely remember the black dog blowing up right at the end. There were some scraps of iron inside its body designed to scatter like a shrapnel when it died. That's why the area smells like a sulfur right now. This probably wasn't the only one built that way. Evidently, Keisuke-san and Rikako-san took down most of them for us. Whereas I could barely handle just one of them. I'm so ordinary. This is laughable. The key's singing again. It shows no sign of stopping now. The key, the song, salvation. After my adrenaline fades, my left arm starts hurting. There's no time to do any first aid on it. Let's go. The key's transforming. What? Is this really the same girl we've been dragging around? She doesn't look the same. Her legs, they're digging into the ground like roots. She can't walk like this. Is the key turning into a tree? What the hell are you? Hearing this song makes me feel uneasy. It feels like everything will be gently torn apart. This isn't a good thing. I need to kill her. I need to kill the key, here and now, before it's too late. Something in my genes is telling me that. Instincts built into my species are warning me that this key is dangerous. But Kotori's holding up a shotgun. She must have found it lying in the field somewhere. Maybe the key isn't a good thing after all. But can you really kill something you've spent this long protecting? Can your heart take it? She smiles, as if laughing at herself, and begins talking.
でも、宿り木の魔物使いたちが編み出した禁断の技術は、鍵の参道、パワースポットから地球の生命力を吸い出して支払いに充てることができる。
Wait, does that mean I'm... Kotori nods. But that means if the key dies...
どうなると思う?私の刺激する魔物すべての生命力が一瞬で枯渇することになる。
Yeah, so if I'm a familiar, I'll die too. Like an electronic device without a power cable.
でも唯一、消息不明の場合。
If the Earth can't confirm the status of the key... I know what she's saying. The dead key will decompose and return its life force to the planet. Just as humans decompose when they die. That will tell the planet that the key died. And then, that source of power will vanish. So, if we can't cut off its connection to the planet, for instance, if we could kill it in a solid concrete room, or maybe Kotori could put up some kind of barrier. So my life won't end immediately. If we can kill the key without letting the planet reclaim its energy, I'll be fine. If we leave the key as is, salvation will happen, but there is no way I'll survive. I can't believe it came to this. Maybe the Earth's been too badly damaged. She points the gun toward the key. Kotori swore to protect the key, but right now she's about to break that vow. Something feels wrong about this. Because this is wrong. I stand between her and the key. I can prove it. That I'm not a familiar. You can order familiars to do anything, right? If I'm a familiar, then I should do exactly what you want. So if I disobey you, that proves I'm not a familiar. I'm willing to throw away everything. So I'm going to force this on you. The hardest possible choice. Kotori starts crying again. Yes. Because I'm not a familiar. I'm the real Tennoji Kotaro. I know. The gun is shaking badly. Hey, Kotori. The key is a burden to you, right? She couldn't revive your parents, she got me badly hurt, and she's forced you to sacrifice most of your life. She's too much for you. Killing her might break your contract and rob you of your powers. But you have had chances to let the other organizations get her. You must have considered doing this before. You must have been wavering back and forth over whether to do it or not. I'll fight your weakness. If you don't have the resolve, then I'll protect the key for you. Until the very end. If I just let you shoot her, you'll always wonder if you made the right decision. So I'm going to do this with you. I hold out my hand. Kotori's silent. The gun's pointing down at the ground. A small hand grabs my fingers. Like a young child clinging to her mother's sleeve. Well, it's the T-Rex. New familiars are standing in the golden field. I just noticed the T-Rex doesn't have arms. Including the dinosaur I saw in the forest. That's the strongest one I know about. But I no longer feel any fear. My mind, at least, is a bit stronger than normal. But there is no way I can beat that. We fought to protect the key, giving up all hope. I have no regrets. I'm just glad we're together for the end. Tell me one last thing. What is salvation? Does it make the world a better place to live? What? An explosion? There's a giant hole in the key's chest. Is that Chizuru? Chizuru? What's she doing here? She's holding an insanely huge rifle and looking down at us. Did she just shoot the key with that thing? The song breaks. The melody changes from clear crystal to the static of a broken radio. A gross horse breaks apart and crumbles into nothing. The key withers. It's like watching a time lapse. It withers thoroughly and rapidly. Unable to just stand there watching it, I grab the key. It's not breathing. It stares off into space, convulsing. That shot was more than enough to kill it. Chizuru looks down, turns away and walks off. The dinosaur also turns around and walks away, shaking the ground with each step. Wait, does the dinosaur belong to Chizuru? Oh, what does this mean? Her, them, and us. All three parties witnessed the end of the conflict. Oh, it's another party, okay. Fireworks light up the night sky. Part of the harvest festival. Am I dreaming? What is this enormous prairie? It's like I've been thrown back to my world after being in another dimension for a long time. At this point, I can't even tell if these are stalks of rice or wheat. But for whatever reason, we're both falling to our knees in a poor rural district after harvest. Chizuru and her rifle are long gone. The key is slipping on the ground. A small hand touches my cheek.
Kotaro.
Eh?
Show me.
Proof? Of what? The key turns to dust and disappears. She's gone. The change happens quickly. Kotori holds her chest and groans. Hey, what? Suddenly I feel an intense thirst. Like suffocating. I'm lacking something I need to survive. I collapse. I can't move my right arm at all. My chest feels like a hot metal rod has been shoved through it, and the pain like my body's being torn apart. Kotori's holding her heart too. Death is approaching both of us. The key's last word. Proof. Proof of what? She can't mean. Kotori, can you release the part of me that's a familiar? Right now, I'm sucking your life, Kotori. No doubt the power spot stopped providing us with energy. This is the result. The familiarized part of my body is trying to gain energy in the normal way. Namely, by draining Kotori's life. We'll both die. Cut the connection. You can do that. Kotori says, dripping cold sweat. The key wants to see if we'll keep fighting. Now, cut the connection. Kotori shakes her head. It's okay, I have an idea. Really, trust me. Yes, a way to save us both. But if this keeps up, we'll both die. So cut it. She hesitates for a moment, then Kotori touches my wounds. What used to fill those holes breaks into little fragments and flies away. But look at that. The hand of the clock is turning backwards. The ribbon I got from the key. Its pieces are a beautiful gold. How's that? You feel better now, right?
どうして?
The contract between me and Kotori is gone now. That means Kotori's fine. The magic ends. And the hand of the clock disappeared. As a result, all of my old wounds come back. Ow, 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 ow. Suddenly, my body feels heavy. I'm in more pain, sharper pain. My vision falls. The air feels dirty, while my senses revert back to a normal human's. This is how much it hurts to live. Calm down, we are just normal humans now, both of us. Now you can live. Calm down, Kotori. Don't miss our last chance. Don't wait for a miracle. Take me to a hospital. Carry me there with your own strength. Let humans heal me the way humans normally do. If we are lucky, they'll save me. Getting to a hospital from here will take over an hour on foot. It's the harvest festival. The crowds and traffic might prevent any ambulance from getting out of the city. Kotori realizes that too. I can't move by myself. Only you can walk. I need to rely on your strength now. I smile. Maybe so, but that's fine. That's what normal people do. Is there blood in my lungs or something? This is gross. So, will you do it? You could just watch me lie here if you want. I'm fine either way. As tears stream from her eyes, a glimmer of resolve finally forms. Yes, that's more like it. Carry me. I'll last a while. I'll do my best not to die along the way. Yeah, I'm missing a lot of parts, so I should be lighter than usual. I'm short on blood too. Okay. Kotori picks me up with all her strength. Without any summoner contracts, my muscles are weak and thin, like dried twigs. Kotori moves her legs. I hear words of encouragement. This is comfy. The scenery becomes blurry. My senses are all being reset, so everything feels dull in comparison now. That's what I get for cheating so much. Of course I can't see straight now. Pace yourself, don't rush. If you trip, you'll lose a lot of time and energy. Rushing won't help, you will get there. As her gait puts pressure on some of my wounds, my words get interrupted. Still, this is pretty nice. Kotori is the one in pain now.
Kambare. Kambare.
She says it twice. Before it was for me, but now it's for her. That's good. Keep it up. Staggering, stumbling. No matter how much I've withered, I still weigh quite a bit. Few girls could carry me easily, but she has to keep trying. She learned how to do that from following the key. Are you watching, Key? This is what humans are capable of. I can feel her shaking. Every time she leans to one side, the whole world tilts. I have no idea what state I'm in right now. It feels like I'm floating. I'm just content. I have no complaints whatsoever about this outcome. Kurudi urges herself onward. I can't see the scenery anymore. Only the night sky. I don't even care how far we've come right now. What is that? Is it one of the black dogs? Huh? Did a familiar show up? So much for hoping they'd let us go. This is kinda bad. The world shakes again. Did she drive it off with willpower alone? That's pretty impressive. Yeah? Okay. She drags her feet toward the city. How long has she been carrying me? I can finally sense that something's changed. Is that people screaming? Oh yeah, that's right. They have massive wounds and profuse bleeding. Profuse. Of course, people would be shocked to see me. Is it Yoshino? I hear a familiar voice. I start to blank out around this part. My eyes are so hazy I can't see anything. It feels like our speed increased. And I'm not shaking as much. There must be someone else helping her. Huh. This is just weird. Right? How much time has passed? My mind is hanging on to consciousness by a thread when I hear Kurudi scream. Thank you. Medical staff. Tennoji-san? Tennoji-san, are you awake? Good. Begin the operation. Laryngoscope. Glottis clear. Beginning tracheal intubation. Cotton ball. Good. Gauze. We are ready. Scalpel. Rotary saw. I regain consciousness 2 days later. I'm sleeping in a hospital bed. When I wake up, a nurse rushes over to my bed. I don't recognize her face, but I understand what this means. I'm alive! My throat hurts when I talk, but I don't care. I survived, I'm alive, and all thanks to humans, not magic. I relish the fact that I'm alive again. I'm back! I'm back! I'm back! Yay! After surgery, I recovered quite well. They started allowing people to visit me before long. I regained my stamina too. But my muscle strength plummeted, no one knows why, so it's gonna be a while before I can walk properly. First, my parents came to see me. For the first time in years, my mother held me and my father rubbed my hair. We remembered Keisuke-san and Rikako-san and cried a little. Kotori didn't come. Why? The police came, not that one, officer. Which one? They asked me a lot about what happened, but eventually decided no one would ever know who hurt me. I think I managed to convince them I had no idea what it was. So apparently everyone's assuming it was some impulsive idiot during the festival attacking me for no reason. I expected suspicious men from secret societies to show up, but they never did. Weird. For bureaucratic reasons, I switched hospitals. I couldn't contact Kotori. Why? My teacher came to visit. She held my hand the entire time we talked. Again, she made me cry. Does she like doing that to people? My classmates came too. They all made me cry too. Damn it. I'd like to make someone else cry for a change. I want to smile while someone else sobs. In the end, I never saw any of the occult club members. Except that one time I saw Chizuru, so I can guess where she went, but that's all. We didn't know each other for very long. We'll probably never see each other again. But I don't think I'll ever be able to forget about that club. Okino-san, a 32-year-old truck driver in the same room as me, lent me some porn books. Yahoo! Yoshino and the leather jacket, I forgot his name, came too. Yay! I tried to make Yoshino cry, but he saw through my act and punched me. I asked them both for a favor. My rehabilitation continues, on rainy and snowy days too. It's painful. Just once, the pain became unbearable and I threw a fit. I calmed down pretty quickly, but I was embarrassed about it for a few days. I borrowed more porn books from Okino-san. That night, I lost the ability to walk while in the bathroom. It was the worst experience of my life. I'll just ignore all the other shameful details. What happens in the hospital stays in the hospital. I'll never be able to live with myself otherwise. I thought I was getting decent at walking, but that's what happens when you get overconfident. My muscles are unbelievably weak now. I guess I've been relying on the Aurora more than I thought. They do say muscles shrivel up when you don't use them, but none of their tests could spot any abnormalities. I don't think anyone found out I had superpowers. Is it even possible for medical science to detect that? It's really mysterious. My rehabilitation continues, not much else happens. I get better at walking, now I can go 20 meters in a row without handrails. Yeah! I finally start wondering what's going on in the outside world. Even after the key disappeared, the world hasn't changed. When I checked a pay-per-view news program, how can they charge money for that? I found that the world was having all the same wars and conflicts and summits and trials as usual. Nothing changed. I still don't know what the key's salvation was. I guess I never will. Or maybe it will come up again in a few hundred years. Maybe that'll be the first time people question killing the key. Humans and the Earth measure time on different scales. A lifetime for a person is an instant for the Earth. Unless a meteor falls on us or something, we don't have to worry about the world ending tomorrow. No doubt, the world will be destroyed very slowly. I spend a lot of time speculating like that. I borrow more porn books from Okino-san. Time passes like dust in the wind. An actress I liked got sued for sexual harassment. The Prime Minister changed. A book about mysterious Kazamatsuri animals becomes a bestseller. Heh. I can't help but think they'll have to take care of that book before worrying about silencing me. Have fun with that, secret society people. Ah, one other thing. Some major corruption in Kazamatsuri was revealed. Tons of stuff was happening in that town. Corruption, occult animals, it's all so mysterious. My rehabilitation continues. They still won't let me out. Given the state of my body, it's hard to blame them. But there's one person I really want to meet. I asked Yoshino to check on her for me, so I'd at least know how she's doing. Apparently she's going to school now, though she's been absent a few days. He said everyone's trying to cheer her up, but she's still pretty sad. Why won't she come visit me? The girls from my class who came to visit immediately told me I don't understand women. What the hell? And late that night, I put together a plan. This might just be enough. It's only pocket change, but it's still a precious war chest built up by not spending too much on snacks and books. I slip into my baggy school uniform. I really have gotten scrawny. These sleeves feel really weird now. I put on my shoes, sneak past the guards and out of the hospital. Success! I stand on an unfamiliar road in an unfamiliar town. The cool night air feels good on my burning cheeks. I run out of breath and my legs go numb after only a few dozen steps. I can't help but feel uneasy about this. Can I really walk all the way there? Yes, I can. With my own strength, not some mystical power. I need to go tell her she should have visited me. Ugh, all the memories. Hey, that's the first CG of the game. Wait for me, Kotori. I'm on my way to see you. On this day, we begin our journey. Pink flower petals float in the wind and brush against my cheek, telling me that spring has come. Is this the end? It feels like the end. It sure is. Yay! We finished Kotori's route of Right, and I have to say, it was a really enjoyable read. Of course, there's still a lot of unanswered questions, like for example, what's up with Chizuru? Who's she really, and why did she kill the key? I was actually thinking about doing Chizuru's route next, but then I started thinking that maybe I should do all the routes that are unlocked from the very beginning before I do any of the routes that are locked at first. I mean, there must be a reason why they are locked. So I'm probably going to do Chihaya's route next. Whenever I decide to continue with Right, I'll probably take a little break before I continue, because I mean, we had now over 60 episodes of Right. I think it's time for something new. Anyway, let's watch the credits and maybe we'll get an epilogue after them. I'll see you then. Oh, we are back at the title screen, so I guess we don't get an epilogue. And look at that, the key's here now.
Chizuru's route unlocked!
Yay! But as I said earlier, I'm gonna do Chihaya's route next. Well then, thanks for watching everyone, and I'll see you then. Bye bye!